fourth chapter Jnana Yogam describes. The fifth chapter is Karma Sannyasa Yogam. Here also he clearly mentions about the first he will differentiate between the Karma Sannyasam and Karma Yogam. Here Karma Yogam is Yogam and Karma Sannyasam is something above this Karma Yogam, that is Jnanam. In that way he mentions like that there are two steps of the same process. The ultimate step is Karma Sannyasam and the preliminary lowermost step is Pranayama Yogam. And then that way, in that chapter, he clearly says how to do Pranayama, what are the effects of Pranayama, and how a yogi can enjoy inside, and how can he get rid of this karma phalam outside. Like that, he clearly narrates in the fifth chapter, that is Karma Sannyasa Yoga. In the sixth chapter, it is otherwise called Atma Sanyama Yogam or Jnana Yogam. This is also telling about this yogam, how a yogi will sit on a platform, how he look like and how he has to, what food he has to take, and what is the future of the yogi, whether he discontinues with this yogam, what is the future of this yogam, and like that he goes on, and what is the difference, what is the distinction between the yogam and other karmas and other jnanas. Like that he is specifically mentioning in this sixth chapter. It is otherwise called Jnana Yogam also. A person who does this pranayama will enter into the final stage, that is called meditation state. That's why it is called Jnana Yogam. Next comes seventh chapter, that is Vijnana Yogam. Vijnana Yogam means, the Vijnana means the practical experience, practical knowledge. The second chapter, Sankhya Yogam, is Jnanam of the Absolute. The fourth chapter, Jnana Yogam, is about Paramatma's incarnation, the purpose of incarnation, and all these mentioned in the fourth chapter. In the seventh chapter, he clearly says about his omnipresence, omnipotence, omniscience. So all these three qualities of God he is mentioning in this seventh chapter. That's why it is called Vijnana Yogam. Vijnana means practical. Jnana means theoretical. And at the same time, he says, unless a yogi knows about my omniscience, omnipotency, and omnipresence, nobody can understand who am I. So in that way, in the seventh chapter, he is saying that when everybody thinks that God means God is like is in a human form, not that I am beyond this human form. Abhyaktam vyaktima pannam manyante mam abuddhiha parambhavam ajananto mamavya manuttam. Like that, I am not a person, but I am beyond this human form. Under my control only, the entire maya or illusion is there. Within that illusion only, everything is happening, and the persons who are trying to know about God, they will be in a different forms. Artho jijnasur ardhadi jnani cha bharatar shabha. There will be four varieties. The devotee will be about in a four varieties. Artho jijnasur ardhadi. One, he is suffering from misery or sorrow. Naturally, he will be praying God. That is the state what we are now facing. So what we are now facing, that is artho. We are now suffering. Jijnasu, some people out of academic interest, they will try to know God. Adhati, after having pretty well know about that God alone will give the possessions or money or wealth, he will also pray. All these are praying. They are also called as devotees. But the fourth one is Jnani. He doesn't want anything from God. He wants only God. But the rest of the three wants to know the vibhutis are the possessions, are the glory of the God, but not God. But anyhow, all these four together, put together, they are called devotees. So like that, in the seventh chapter, he mentions about the Vijnana Yogam. In the eighth chapter, that is Akshara Parabrahma Yogam. Akshara Parabrahma Yogam means the he tells about what is Parabrahma, what is Aksharam, which is imperishable, and the combination between the Paramatma and the body. When a person leaves this body, what will happen to him in the future birth? Like that, he is going on mentioning. And not only that, what he tells about the creation. In the creation, how the creation comes, and in that creation, how long we will live, and how long we can do this sadhana, and how a yogi will be differentiating between the pravrutti and nivrutti, and what are the benefits of doing yogam. Like that, he goes on mentioning in the Akshara Parabrahma Yogam, and in that he clearly mentions about this. Omichyakaksharam Brahma Vyaharanma Manasvaram Yah Prayati Chajandeham Sayati Paramangatim. Like that, the Omkaram is here, is Pranayama. By doing this Pranayama only, he can cross over the three bodies, that is Stola Soshma Karanadehas, and will enter into the Brumajjam, that is Brumajje Pranamavesa Samyak Satam Param Purusham Upaiti Divyam. Like that, he will penetrate his life force, enter in through that Brahmarandram, and enter into this third ventricle, and then only he will see the divine light. Like that, he mentions in this eighth chapter, and the ninth chapter comes, that is Rajavijja Rajaguhi Yogam. Rajavijja Rajaguhi Yogam. This Yogam, here you understand, he is explaining in different ways about the yogam only, but there are no separate 18 yogas. But the same yogam is being mentioned in different ways. Here he is telling the difficult or easiness of the yogam. Rajavijja Rajagushyam. It is the vijja, it is the method, it is the king of all the methods, and it is the secret of all the secrets, and it is very easy to practice, and whatever you do, its fruit will never be perished. Like that, and he is mentioning, and he is telling about how easy this one, and he is neutral to everybody, he is not partial, and if anybody, even if he is with the vices or with any papachara, like that, but I will be lifting him only when provided he does this yogam within himself. Ananya chintayantvamam yajana paryupasate yesham nityabhiyuktanam yogakshamam ahamyaham. Like that, a person, even if he does something wrong outside, whether he is doing bad karma, but if he does this internal pranayama, for him only God protects him in the form of yogakshamam. He will protect, and he will give opportunity to proceed inside by creating such an opportunity, like that what we are having this time to proceed inside. He will provide that opportunity, and he will protect the what all the fruit yielded during yogam, kshemam vahamyam. Like that, he is mentioning in the ninth chapter. Then coming to the tenth chapter, that is Vibhuti Yogam. Vibhuti Yogam means he will be telling, telling about the glory of the God, glory of the universe, the entire universe. The entire universe is nothing but his glory only, and systematically, methodically, he mentions about the universe. In that universe, suppose a group of things are there in the universe. He will mention that the top of that group, I am that group. Like that, when he mentions about the all the heads, I am that heads only. The rest of things are nothing but I am only. Like that, he tells about the vibhuti. Vibhuti here means vibhutir bhutir aishwaryam. That means vibhuti, bhuti and aishwaryam. All the glory are nothing but vibhuti only. In that way, after telling everything, ultimately tells that what is the use of knowing about all these things? You try to know me directly. If you know me, you can know everything. Otherwise, it is also a waste. Adava bohunaitena kimjatena tavarjuna vestabhyahamidam krishnam ekasena stito jagat. The entire universe is within a part of me, but I am apart from that part. I am four parts, and one fourth is only the studied with this entire universe. Padoasya visvabhutani tripadasya amrutam divyeti. Like that in Chandogya Upanishad it says my universe is only 1/4 of it, but I am rest of the 3/4, I am the amruta swarupa. I am full of this brahmanandam or eternal bliss. This is about the 10th chapter, and in that 10th chapter he says that I am atma, aham atma gudakesa sarvabhuta sayasthita aham aditya majjancha bhutanam antayavacha. If anybody is hearing about this Bhagavad Gita, thinks that I am a human form. I am not the human form, but I am atma only. That is, I am there in everybody. And not only that, I am aham aditya majjancha bhutanam antayavacha. Before his birth and after his death and between in his form, I am there everywhere. So like that, I am atma, who is imperishable, and it is who is constant. But the person who is getting birth is only impermanent. Like that, he is mentioning about the permanent nature of Paramatma that is there in told in 10th chapter, Vibhuti Yogam. Coming to the Visvarupa Santarasana Yogam. Visvarupa Santarasana Yogam. Here, what all he mentioned in Vibhuti Yogam, he practically shown to Arjuna by giving him this third eye, by giving him Chakshujnanam, Divya Chakshuhu. Divya Chakshuhu means divine eye. Here divine eye means not eye, but he has elevated. Lord Sri Krishna elevated him to the center of the eyebrows, and there he ordered him to see the entire universe within your Brahmajam. Like that, he shows the entire Visvarupam in his head only. But to see this Visvarupam, to whom it is possible, here also he mentions about this Ananya Bhakti. Ananya Bhakti, Bhakya, Tanaya, Sakya, Ahameva Vidojana, Yatum Drashtincha Tapena, Praveshtincha Parantapa. For the person who does this yogam in this way, jatum drashtum cha tattvena praveshtum cha parantapa, by entering, penetrating into the Brahmaridram and seeing the divine light and coming to know that the entire universe is derived from this light only, yad yad vibhuti matsutam srimad urjatameva tatadeva avajatvam. In the 10th chapter, he mentions that the entire universe came from my light only. Like that, to see this entire universe, you have to, a yogi alone, competent to see this universe by taking his life force upward by doing pranayama, that is called Ananya Bhakti. This is about Visvarupa Santarasana Yogam. In the 13th chapter, the 12th chapter, that is a Bhakti Yogam. Here also, Bhakti, the Bhaktas are about two types, that is Sagunopasaka and the Nirgunopasaka. The Sagunopasaka means I used to mention, the Sagunam is nothing but the divine light, that is Saguna Brahman. By doing yoga only, he can do this Sagunopasana. Whereas some people, without doing this yogam, some people they think that I am doing Nirgunopasana. Nirgunopasana means I'll try to see God everywhere, but I cannot say exactly how he is. But this is quite impossible, utterly impossible. He says in Bhakti Yogam, Lord Sri Krishna says, Kleso Adhikarastesham, Avyakta Saktachetasam, Avyakta Bahidru Gatidukham, Dehavat Bhivapite. A person having body sense can never do Nirgunopasana. His ultimate remedy only to resort is to go through Sagunopasana. That Sagunopasana is by doing Yogam. That is about the 12th chapter, that is Bhakti Yogam. Coming to the 13th chapter, Kshetra Kshetrajna Vibhag Yogam. In this chapter, Lord Sri Krishna clearly mentions he is separating between the Kshetra and the Kshetrajna. Kshetrajna is the reflecting agent, that is Chaitanyam, and the Kshetram is the body and the Antakarana Chatushtayam. This is the basis on which the Chaitanyam is reflecting. In that way, the nature, the naked nature is the Kshetram, and the Chaitanyam, the divine force acting on this Kshetram is Kshetrajna. Kshetrajna means the one who knows about the Kshetram. Idam sariram kaunti kshetravijnadite etatso yuvatat yo viditam prahu. Kshetrajna iti tadvidaha, one who knows about the Kshetram. Here also, you know, Kshetram means body. One who knows about body means, the doctors also, they have dissected every nook and corner of the body. He also knows about this body, but it doesn't mean that he knows about this body. He only dissects this body physically only, but he doesn't know about the nature of the life force which is circulating in the body. The person who does pranayama and who has got control of the life force can only be called as Kshetrajna. He is God alone. He is Paramatma. So just by knowing about the physical body, you can never be called as Kshetrajna. By knowing, by practicing, and by controlling the life force, he only called as Kshetrajna. That is Sri Krishna Paramatma. In that, he clearly distinguishes and separates, differentiates between the nature and the Purusha, Prakriti and Purusha, Prakriti and Purusha. The Prakriti is nature and the Purusha is the absolute. So combination of this Purusha, Prakriti and Purusha is Bhagavan. Combination of Prakriti and Purusha is Bhagavan. In this, the Kshetra Kshetrajna Vibhaga Yogam, he mentions how a person who knows doing this yogam only can understand the nature of this Paramatma who is reflecting on this Kshetram. Anajitva Nirgunatvat Paramatma Ayamavyaha Sirurastopa Kauntya Nakuroti Nalipyate. Like that, he is telling that though I am acting on the body itself, but I am not at all connected with it. Nakaroti nalipyate. I am not at all doing anything. I am not at all contacted with anything. Like that, he is always alone. But he appears to be in contact with this Prakriti. Like that, he says, Prakritim purushan chaiva vijjanadi ubhavapi vikaravasya gunachaiva vidhi prakriti sangam bhavan. The he differentiate between the Prakriti and the Purusha. The Prakriti is the thing responsible for doing all these actions or vikaras or the sensations, all these creation. But the Purusha, he looks like it's alone, sits alone without any action. He will be seen sitting like a sakshi, like a witness. Like that, he is mentioning about this Kshetra Kshetrajna Vibhag Yogam. Then coming to the 14th chapter, that is Gunatraya Vibhag Yogam. Here Gunatrayam means the Satta Rajas Tama Guna. These three gunas are nothing but they are the part and parcel of this Maya, that is illusion. Satta Rajas Tamayati Guna Prakriti Sambhava Nebadhanti Mahabaho Dehe Dehinam Avyayam. Like that, the three gunas, sattva, rajas, tamas, gunas are the ingredients of this maya or illusion, and according to the part the person behaves, according to sattvam, he will behavior will be something like that, and depending upon the gunas, the person will be acting according to the gunas only. And if he does this yogam,